Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. Just trying to make a couple of videos tonight. Haven't made a video in at least a week. You know, as the Lord leads me, I make them. Praise God. Thank the Lord. I'm not perfect by no means, brothers and sisters. By no means. Under the blood of Jesus and the grace of God. You know, the Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse... I was just looking at it. Verse 20. I've quoted it many times, but I just wanted to look it up because it was the verse that was in my spirit tonight as I was praying, talking to the Lord. It says, but where sin aboundeth, grace did much more abound. And so that part, you know, that point of that verse is that the grace of God is more than enough for us. Even as the Lord told Paul, you know, my grace is sufficient for you. So no matter how much we sin, no matter how much you've sinned, no matter how much I've sinned, the grace of God is more than enough for us. It abounds more than any sin that we could ever do, brothers and sisters. And brothers and sisters, let me add on to that now. Let me say, because, you know, we have, and you know, you guys who've been following me, you know there's two ends of this thing, two bookends. One is people that, as Paul says in the next few verses, like two verses later, in Romans chapter 6, verse 1, he says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And then verse 2, God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any there longer therein? And then he talks about when you're baptized, symbolic of being buried with Christ and resurrected. And, you know, the old man is dead. You know, behold, all things are new. The old man has passed away. Behold, all things become new. So we're new creatures in Christ. But brothers and sisters, we still sin. We still have the human sin nature as long as we're on this earth. Okay, brothers and sisters, but through the blood of Jesus and by faith through grace, we have right standing with God when we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ in our heart, when we confess our sins, when we repent and call on the name of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, that's what it means to call on the name of the Lord. Jesus, I need to be saved. Jesus, save me. Just as Peter, when he was sinking in the water, it's really symbolic of sinking in our sin. You know, Peter began to sink. What was his sin? Was doubt and unbelief. You know, the Bible even says there when it talks about the people that will not enter the kingdom of heaven, it talks about all liars will have their place in the lake of fire. And it's got these different lists of things like the effeminate, which means basically the way, you know, a homosexual, and particularly who acts like a queen, they call it, you know, who really acts like a woman, effeminate. But another one of those things, brothers and sisters, of people who cannot enter the kingdom of heaven is the fearful. You don't hear anybody talking about that. The fearful will not enter the kingdom of heaven. And I'm just laughing to myself now because the people who I talk to, who I know who are fearful, they're going to be more fearful because God says that no fearful will enter the kingdom of heaven. The point of that, brothers and sisters, of course, we're all human. But what it's saying is, the main thing that we need to know is to, you know, doubt and unbelief leads to fear. Like Peter when he was walking on the water that time, brothers and sisters. As I've said before, everybody loves to keep saying about Jesus walking on water, but you never hear anybody too much talking about that Peter got out of the boat and walked on water. Now, besides the fact, the whole other message of the point that how the other apostles didn't even get out of the boat. Okay, so Peter gets a big thumbs up. When people do talk about Peter, they never say the good point. Peter was the only one who had the guts to get out of the water on the command of the Lord. He said, if it be you, Lord, call me to come unto you. And the Lord gave the command, come. And, you know, I heard one preacher say one time, because the Bible tells us, you know, we stand on the promises of God. And there's a song, you know, the old hymnal, standing on the promises of God. So this, I heard one preacher say that when, you know, and it's a really good one. It's the only person maybe ever heard preach about this, as a matter of fact, about Peter walking on the water. And he was saying that Peter was walking on the word, come, the command. The Lord gave him the command, come, you know, C-O-M-E in English. And that Peter was walking on that word straight from the Lord's mouth. The Lord had spoken it, and there it was. So the Lord had given him the command to come forward on the water. And anyway, brothers and sisters, my focus is to talk about how the fact that Peter began to sink when he began to have doubt and unbelief, brothers and sisters. He began to look at the waves, the circumstances, the problems going on around him. Even us, if we begin to look at the sin in our lives, you know, we're Christians, right? Most of the people watching this video are Christians. So when we have sin, which we all have sin, everybody sins every day. Only Jesse Duplantis is the only one, you know, who has the audacity to say that he goes 30 days at a time without sinning. Pride, sounds like to me. He definitely sounds prideful to me. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we're all sinners, and God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. The point I'm trying to get to is that when we have sin, even though, you know, most people, if they were talking about Peter walking on the water, they would see the waves and the storm as, you know, a danger or as problems in our life and all that. But in this case, I'm talking about as the sin in our lives. And we would look at that and say, well, you know, I can't walk on the water. I can't, you know, God's not going to use me to pray for somebody to be healed, or God's not going to use me to, you know, to tell my neighbor about Jesus or my coworkers about Jesus because I did ABC yesterday. When in reality, the Bible says that Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He's the accuser of the brethren. So what does it say? One of the biggest things I deal with of people in doubt and unbelief and fearfulness is they never read in their Bible 1 John 1:9. And it says, I probably give that Bible verse to people more than any other Bible verse I give to anybody. And it says, if we confess our sins, he's written to the church. He's talking to Christians. For all of you once saved, always saved people, on the bookend of saying that, you know, you believed on Jesus and you lived like the devil the rest of your life and you don't ever need to repent and all that. Okay, that's one bookend of the bookends I'm talking about at the beginning of this video. The other bookend of those people who think, you know, they stub their foot on the door and say S-H-I-T, then they fall over dead. They went to hell because they said H-I-T before they fell over dead. You know, every little thing you do, you lose your salvation, you gain it back, you lose your salvation, you gain it back. And they're living in fear and unbelief and doubt and unbelief in the blood of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, that's why God put me on YouTube. And I know there's all this stuff going on in the news, and I know that the Lord, you know, led me, and I've done seminars in the Philippines, pastor seminars on end times and all that. And all that's true. We are living in the times that's going to the time for the rapture and the tribulation and all that. And that's what people run to and fro wanting to hear. But in the meantime, as long as we're on this earth, what people need to hear is not someone trying to calculate the date for the rapture, which could be tomorrow, it could be in 5 minutes from now, and it could be 6 months from now, it could be 2, 3, 4, 5 years from now. We don't know. No man knows the day or the hour, but we know we're in the season. But what people do need to know is about their walk with the Lord and about the Lord himself, brothers and sisters. So that's why the Lord put me on here, to bring those two extremes that I see, you know, and as obviously, I take that back. It's not even what I see. It's what the Lord put me on YouTube for. Because when I'm making my videos, I'm asking the Lord about the end times. I'm asking the Lord about, you know, all this stuff about understanding, about the coming of the new world order and all that. And then the Lord will start giving me stuff like what I'm doing right now, brothers and sisters. So this is what needs to be heard. For the Bible said, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8:14. And so I praise God, you know, that he's carrying me along by his Holy Spirit to give you his words. And so 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So, as I was saying earlier, that verse, brothers and sisters, is to the church. 1 John is written to the church. I'm not talking for all you Baptists out there, all of you once saved, always saved people that believe you never have to repent again after you get saved, whoever you are. It's not all Baptists. Lots of Baptists I know don't believe in once saved, always saved. But the official doctrine is that. So, excuse me, you know, I'm just making a general statement for those who are, you know, FYI, for people who don't know these different denominational beliefs. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so writing to the church, the Apostle John, the same one who wrote Revelation, who was the disciple whom Jesus loved, he said, under the unction of the Holy Spirit, if we Christians confess our sins, he, God, the Lord, Jesus Christ, is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You know, and then there's several other Bible verses that says that, you know, he remembers our sin no more. They've been cast in the sea of forgetfulness. As far as the east is from the west, so shall our sins be from us. You know, a lot of those are from Isaiah, like Isaiah chapter 1. You know, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. He's talking about the future when the blood of the Messiah would wash away our sins. In the Old Testament, people's sins were covered covered by the blood of bulls and goats. But in the New Testament, by the blood of Jesus, our sins are washed away. It's a total different thing. It's not covering, but removing. That's the New Testament, brothers and sisters. That's the power in the blood. Like they say, there's power, like that song, there's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. You know, that's the Jesus is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Even as John the Baptist declared, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. You know, and He is our Christ, our Lord, our Messiah, our Redeemer. That's why it says in 2 Timothy 1:7, that's another verse that I have to quote to people all the time, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So if we are Christians and we are filled with God's Spirit, we should have that Holy Spirit of power, of love, and a sound mind. God did not give us double-mindedness, James. And I refer, that's from the book of James, where it says about do not be double-minded. Brothers and sisters, that's, you know, I'm just thinking about it now. That's one way you know that someone is, I was just thinking about this today because someone asked me about someone who makes videos. And I can't think of his name. He's a Hispanic guy. And anyway, in his videos, he keeps quoting from some woman prophet. You know, he's like, kind of like the Seventh-day Adventists, they keep quoting from that Ellen White, and they'll say, you know, there was some seminar that was on YouTube about end times. I didn't know it was Seventh-day Adventists. I started watching it. And then they were saying that, you know, Ellen White wrote in her book on page 184 that this would happen in the end times and all this stuff. And then this dude that I'm talking about, he's a pretty young-looking guy, too. As a matter of fact, it looks a lot like the guy from Saved by the Bell or whatever. You know, that's after my time. But the guy, he's on TV now. He kind of looks a lot like that dude. I'm trying to think of his name. He does some TV shows and different stuff now, especially for children and stuff like that. He looks a lot like that guy. He keeps quoting from this woman prophet. So one of the best ways you know you're dealing with a cult or the wrong doctrine is when someone is quoting from A, what they read upside down in one of the pyramids, or on some kind of ancient petroglyph from that was made by man under the inspiration of fallen angels or demons in the old days, pre-flood days. Or if you're listening to someone who keeps quoting from some, you know, what Ellen G. White said, that's a clue that it's not from God. But when you hear someone who keeps quoting from the Bible verses over again, that's not mean they're necessarily preaching correctly and preaching the Word of God as the Lord would have it done. But it's a big plus, brothers and sisters. And when I start making my videos, if you guys watch me, while I'm speaking, all these Bible verses are coming to me. You know, and that's one way that I know that it's the Holy Spirit, because God usually speaks to us. A lot of people ask me, you know, they want to hear from God and all that. Most of the time, God doesn't speak to us what we want to hear, but He speaks to us usually from His Word. Usually from His Word. You know, brothers and sisters, I want to put that on there too as a caution. Because, you know, I am a Spirit-filled, you know, Christian. But there are lots of extreme people, or some extreme people in the Pentecostal movement who were obviously, you know, not rooted and grounded in the Word. And I've mentioned this in videos before. When I have done revivals in Baptist churches and denominational churches like that, non-Pentecostal churches, the Lord leads me to start talking to them. You're rooted and grounded in the Word, but you have no Spirit. The Word gives, you know, brings death, but the Spirit gives life. You know, it's all Word and no Spirit. It's like eating bread and not drinking water. That bread gets stuck in your throat, that daily bread. You can eat all the bread you want, but you got to have some water to wash it down. You need both. You need bread and water. You know, man cannot live by bread alone, right? As the Lord Jesus Christ quoted from Deuteronomy. But on the other extreme, in the Pentecostal movement, there's people that's getting all these words from the Lord, and they're not rooted and grounded in the Word. And, you know, and I'm not too big into getting into it with people, which I usually don't. There are people that go on YouTube to debate and argue with people. But there are a few of them who I've had contact with as the Lord had led me. I private messaged them, not publicly. And the first thing that they came back to me with was themselves as their authority. What's your authority? Me. I'm the authority. God, you know, the Archangel Michael anointed me and told me I'm the man. I'm the prophet. So therefore, no one can come against anything I say. Now, there's two or three that have told me that. There's one that says he is the Archangel Michael. First, he was one of the 144,000. Then he was Elijah, and now he's the Archangel Michael. You know, and that's how it goes, brothers and sisters. Instead of going from glory to glory, sad to say, not going from glory to glory, but from depth of deception to depth of deception to depth of deception, brothers and sisters. You know, and that's why, you know, I'm not in it for the views of my videos, brothers and sisters, but to come on here and give the plain gospel message as the Lord would lead me. The plain gospel message as the Lord would lead me. And bring that balance between grace and works. And bring the balance between being spirit-filled. You know, being spirit-filled is the balance between being, you know, so rooted in the Word that you can't be moved even by the Spirit of God. And then on the other extreme, people that are tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. And I deal with people all across the spectrum and those things every day, brothers and sisters. And I think, you know, that's what the Lord put me on here for. So praise God for that. Thank the Lord that He gave me a mission, something to do for His glory. And I thank Him for it. And I ask each of you to pray that God would give you something to do and what He wants you to do. Brothers and sisters, God bless.